Not only can MATLAB handle vectors, column vectors, row vectors, but it can also handle matrices, usually two-dimensional matrices that have rows and columns to it, but it can actually handle three-dimensional, four-dimensional, or really any dimensional matrix that you want to use, which we'll be using later. But to make a matrix, we make it very similar to how we make a vector. So let's just say I want a 2x2 matrix. So if I want to put in the top row of the matrix, let's say is 1 and 5, and the bottom row of the matrix is 6 and 7. So we see here again I use that square bracket command. I put in that top row, 1, 5, I put a semicolon to tell it to go to the next row, and then 6 and then 7. So if I push enter, I've now saved into the variable A the 2x2 matrix 1, 5, 6, and 7. And we can use matrices in functions similar to how we used vectors in functions. So going back to that sine command, I can take the sine of A, and it's going to take the sine of each element in A. Similar to log 10 of A, I can take the 10 log of each of these values individually. And like we saw with vectors, I can take, if I do a dot squared here, I can take A and I can square each individual element of A if I use the dot caret 2. However, with the matrix, I can also do A squared, and it does matrix multiplication like you know from linear algebra, and we see that we get different results here. I'm not taking each individual element and squaring it like I do with the dot caret, but really what I'm doing is I'm taking my matrix and multiplying it by itself, which I can do with a square matrix. So I see that A squared, or A caret 2, is the same as A matrix times A matrix. It gives me the same result there. I can also cube it. I can do this because I have square matrices. All right, so that's how I can make a matrix. In this case, I'll stick with a 2x2 matrix for the moment. And I can use it in functions just like I did with vectors. So I can do the same operation on a lot of pieces of it. If I take A again, I can transpose my matrix just as I did before. So I can flip it like a transpose here. And for a 2x2 matrix, or really any square matrix, I can take its determinant, assuming that it's an invertible matrix. So to take the determinant of a matrix, of a square matrix, I can use this command, DET of A. And we see here that DET takes the determinant of the matrix. Now for a small matrix, it's easy enough to do by hand what the determinant is. So going back to A, we know that the determinant of this matrix will be 1 times 7 minus the quantity of 5 times 6. And that's how we get the negative 23. But let's say we have a bigger matrix, and here we really don't want to be taking determinants by hand. I'll do a 3x3 matrix. And we see here we have another square matrix that we're dealing with. I can take the determinant of B, and it gives me very quickly what that numerical answer is, 134. Doing this by hand would take us longer to do, and if we have an even bigger square matrix, 4x4 or larger, it's going to keep taking us by hand. We're not going to want to do that anymore, and MATLAB can do that very quickly, again, taking the determinant of our matrix. Also what I can do with square matrices that we see in linear algebra is we might be interested in finding the eigenvalue of our matrix. So again, for 2x2s, these are not necessarily that hard to do, but to do by hand. But we see if we have that A matrix, that 2x2, we can find that has, we expect two eigenvalues, and we find that has two eigenvalues, negative 2.2 and 10.2. The larger our matrices get, the more eigenvalues we get out of them, and the more complicated they become. So in this case, for that B matrix, I have three eigenvalues that I can find using that eig command. And if you're interested in using eigenvalues, the eig command actually gives you a lot more out. It can give you the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors automatically. Right, so more of that later when we're dealing with eigenvalues, but those are specific to when we're using a matrix. All right, let's go back to our matrix A. Make another matrix here so I can do another 2x2. All right, so using linear algebra rules, I can multiply matrices together the same way I would if I were doing it by hand. So since A is 2x2 and C is 2x2, I am allowed to multiply them together and get that result A times C, which I can store as another matrix. I'll just for now call that H. So just like we saw in vectors, I can pull out just specific values in my matrix. So taking this A matrix, let's just say I want that upper left value, that 15 in this case. I can pull out specific values if I say I want the first row, first column entry. So 1, 1 is going to give me the value that's in the first row of H and in the first column of H. As we expect, 15. Same thing here. If I put 2, 1, it's going to give me the value in the second row of H, but the first column, which is the 44. And in this case, let's go back to the bigger matrix we had, B. Let's just say I only want to know what's the second column of B. So what I can do, again, the first argument it takes is which row am I talking about? Well, here, I can put a colon there, and that's going to say I want all rows. But in the second spot, if I only want the second column, I'll put a 2 there. And what this should return is just that second column of B. And the same idea here, let's just say I only want the last row of B, then I want the third row, but every column. As my output, I get 1, 2, and 7. So for the matrices, I can be pulling out specific values. I can pull out just one column or just two columns or specific rows. So let's go one more. Let's say I just want the bottom two rows of B. Then what I want is rows 2 to 3, but I want all the columns. So in that case, I only get those bottom two rows of B, 6, 8, 4, 1, 2, and 7.